So how long has this movie been for you at this point?
Well, I mean, we finished filming last June. Uh-huh. I handed it over in early November of last year, and I thought, that's it, surely. And then we did Sundance in January. The film came out in the UK April. We did Tribeca in May, Seattle June, LA Festival, and now I'm doing the whole round because we've got it July 24th coming out. And then I go back home, and in August it's the DVD in the UK. So we do the whole thing again.
And then the DVD here.
And then the DVD here, and then no doubt the extended recut.
Yes.
Directors, the 3D version.
You know, the joy of the award season also
that's right.
will be coming upon you.
And surround sound swearing and yeah, all that kind of thing.
So when you wrote the piece, or when you guys wrote the piece,
yeah.
was it designed to be an across the pond thing, or was that part of your plan?
No, I mean, I thought clearly with the cast and the story,
right.
there would be some appeal.
Yeah.
I didn't know whether in America the audiences would just hate the idea of having the collective faces rubbed in
right.
the events of the last 8 years, or whether they'd take to it. And it seems to be a lot of people say they found it quite therapeutic to see the last 8 years
yeah.
sort of summed up and thrown away like that.
But do the British like having their face rubbed in it more than we do? Is that the,
Well, I think our natural attitude is one of cynicism and inherent disappointment.
Uh-huh.
You know, a British politician made a speech about 3 months ago saying, you know, why can't writers make television shows in the UK
right.
like The West Wing? You know, why can't we portray politicians as being noble and upright and
uh-huh.
clever and good looking and so on? And I think the answer is because we would probably laugh at that. We'd find it funny, but for the wrong reason, really. We
right.
wouldn't take it seriously.
So you were in a tradition of television in Britain, coming out of that.
Yeah.
I mean, Johnny Mortimer died recently, sadly.
Yeah.
Was that your, I think he did Yes Minister, didn't he? Or
no, that's Jonathan Lynn and Anthony Jay and Jonathan
okay.
Lynn, yeah.
So, but I mean, is that the tradition you come out of, or is there another more anarchic?
Well, there's two, really. There's sort of satirical tradition in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
Like Yes Minister was a great, I loved Yes Minister. But I also, in making the film, I very much wanted to make a screwball comedy. You know,
huh.
I wanted to make a fast-talking,
uh-huh.
really fast-moving story with a plot that spins tighter and tighter and tighter as the thing progresses. So
does it change a lot in post for you, or did you? Was that pretty much
well,
the script?
Well, post was interesting. No, in the script, it was there. But in post, and the first cut was about 4 hours long because we have lots of improvisation and
mm-hmm.
stuff like that. In post, though, that's where you kind of ask yourself, who am I really interested in?
Right.
You know, we have all these characters, and
mm-hmm.
some we follow more than others. But in the final edit, I'm asking myself, who are the ones that we really want to know about?
Mm-hmm.
And that's when we find the edit gravitates towards. I'm sure, if someone else came along and got
right.
all the rushes, they'd make a completely different film. But this is the film. And I also wanted to make it an hour and 40 minutes. I didn't want it to make it longer than that, because I think a comedy has a natural
right.
Time, limit to it. And
right.
once you get beyond that, you stop laughing. You've just,
it's
you know,
keep farce
you,
going
you've
for
had
two
enough.
And a half hours.
Exactly. So that was the real, the real trauma was getting it from, easy to get it from 4 hours down to about 2 hours 10.
Right.
The 2 hours 10 down to 1 hour 40 was the last 2 months.
But you kind of had a target when you went into the project.
Yeah.
You kind of knew what you... I mean, how different is it? Is it a big transition for you to go from film to cinema? Anything like that?
I don't know. I mean, I tried not to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
I knew that I wanted, obviously, to pace it a lot differently. You know, in a
right.
TV show, you've got 30 minutes. You've really got to get everything up and running within
yeah.
the first 5 minutes. The film, I knew I wanted to hold certain key characters back
right.
for the second half of the film, not even see them. The Steve Coogan's character
mm-hmm.
is a little while in before we see him.
Yeah.
James Gandolfini, we don't see for the first half hour or so.
Right.
I wanted to get the momentum going
mm-hmm.
and then as it's spinning, add another ball to the, and then 15 minutes later, add
mm-hmm.
another, so that by the end you've got, a dozen balls in the air, really.
And what was the writing process? Is it
writing process? There's myself and three other writers and who have worked closely together on other stuff. And I love collaboration, partly because it doesn't feel like work when you collaborate. You know, it's that thing of sitting down by yourself with a blank sheet of paper or a laptop, you know, opened a new document and there's nothing, you know. That's the horrible thing. But when you're in a room, we spend a lot of time on the plot, really backwards and forwards, passing it around. Been an awful lot of time on the plot. There was a bit of research went into it as well. I went out to Washington and met people who'd worked in the White House and the Senate and State Department, who told me, you know, I said, I don't want the scandal and I want the dull stuff. I want to know when people get in, what time do they go home, what it's like where they work.
Well, that's the humanity of this piece.
Exactly.
Right?
What tricks do people pull and all that sort of thing.
Mimi's teeth.
Well, Mimi's teeth, her bleeding gums, she leaves a meeting because her gums are beating. That's because somebody told us that in Washington, the golden rule is never leave a meeting. If you leave a meeting, you leave power. Because big decisions are suddenly made at these meetings. You know, there's not going to be a second chance. Madeleine Albright taught her staff what she called bladder diplomacy, which was how to last in a meeting for up to 6 hours.
Wow.
And I bring this back to the writers and we think, okay, what would be the last thing? Mimi's character wouldn't want to leave a meeting, especially if her arch nemesis, Linton, was chairing it. She'd never want to leave. What's the one thing that would provoke her to leave a meeting? We thought, what if her lips and gums started bleeding? And then you go back and feed that storyline into the plot. And, you know, and that's how it kind of developed. Sort of very organically.
But in a lot of these things, you know, it's usually somebody has a story and then writers throw gags in and stuff. But it sounds like you guys really worked everything.
No, we involve the story and then we get the cast on board early on so that the writers know who's playing the parts. And then we write the characters with those actors in mind.
So which percentage of the actors did you guys know? No. I mean, had you worked with everybody before? Half the
people? No, but I had met about... I hadn't worked with Tom Hollander before or Gina McKee before. I had worked with Chris Addison and Peter Capaldi. I hadn't worked with any of the US cast before, but I did a casting process out in New York and in LA. And the way I cast is I give them some scenes to read, but I also ask them to improvise and to stay in character while I ask them questions.
Because it's a great improv cast.
I mean. They're all, and all of them actually in the end have had some experience. I mean, Zach Woods, who plays Chad, the young sort of obnoxious climber in the State Department, he comes from the Upright Citizens Brigade, who are an improv troupe in New York. And when I saw him, and I was thinking of him as Chad, and I saw Anna Klumsky, and I was thinking of her as Liza, while I was still casting, I got the casting director to put the two of them together, and I told them to just start insulting each other. And they went on for about half an hour. It was extraordinary.
But ironically, it's like also one of the nicest group of actors. I mean, you look at this list of the actors.
Yeah.
They all seem like people who are actually relatively easy to work with. Right?
Absolutely. Well, there's no point. You know, if you're making a comedy, there's no point there being a sour atmosphere on set or someone who doesn't want to. And I, you know,
so is that part of the choosing?
Absolutely. I outlined the process in advance and I told them what how we'd be working. And some of them were kind of, great, I've done that before. Others were, I've never done that before, but let's give it a go, you know. James Gandolfini said, you know, he's so used to being told, stand there, that's the line, say that, that's what's on the page. And he said, let's give it a go, because he loved the script. Let's give it a go. And he went out and he did research. He went of his own, he went to the Pentagon. He rang up the Pentagon, and you know, if you're James Gandolfini, you can ring people up and they can go, yeah, we'd love to have you. And he took four-star generals out for dinner and watched how they walked and talked, and he went to the Pentagon barbers for a haircut, and you know.
And now he's like the farceur of New York.
Now he's got this natural comic talent. And yeah, while he was filming this in London, he saw God of Carnage in the London West End, thought it was great, and said, Luke, do you want to take this to Broadway? And I'll
so you
be
shot
in
the US stuff in London?
We, some of the interiors in London, the State Department, we built in a sports hall in London. And there's a scene in the children's bedroom where General Miller and Karen are, that was in the squash court in this. But other scenes we shot in Washington. We came out to Washington and shot, we had a couple of weeks in Washington and we did obviously all the exteriors and a few of the interiors as well.
So is casting somebody like Gandolfini for you, like casting Tony Soprano? I mean, is that where you know him from?
I'd known him, but we had spoken about some other projects because I'm doing something with HBO and I'm doing it through his production company. So I knew him prior to it, and it was only as we were writing the script and this character, this general, came up that I thought, do you know, he'd be really, let's give it a go. And I sent him the script and met up with him in New York, and he said, let's do it. Really, really funny. Let's do it.
And like, did you know me and David's work before this?
I'd seen some of David's work. Mimi was the last person I saw for that part, and I was all about to get on a plane and head home, and we stayed another day, but I really had to go, and I was thinking, I'll just have to rethink this whole thing, and then Mimi came in, and it was like, there she is, perfect. And then, of course, I discovered she's got this whole background of comedy, satire, and she's quite involved politically, and, you know, so she has friends in Washington, so she was able to get all the detail, and and Anna,
saw her in My Girl.
I know. And then only after she was cast do I find out that when she stopped being a sort of child actress, went to college, she went to Washington, studied in Washington, and had a job for 6 months as a staffer there. And so again, she knew just what to do.
So what's your set like? Do you have a specific styles director that you know?
Well, I like, we try to find a location where we can have as many of the, we try to find a building where we can have as many of the locations as possible. So as much as possible, I can shoot in story order. And the set, we dressed either pre-existing buildings, or we constructed the State Department in a big empty hall, which we turned into a kind of soundstage. And we light it very generally. We put in the ceilings, we hide the lights as much as we can, and use lots of natural lights as well. Hide microphones as much as possible, so that we're not having to stop and restart. Right. You know, we're not having to light for the wide shot and then the close up, and everything stops for 2 hours while we relight for the reverses and stuff like that.
Had you worked with this cameraman a lot?
Yeah.
So you're used to each other.
And he knows where to find the funny, you know. We have two cameras on the go at every stage, shot in HD, handheld, everyone's radio mic'd, no marks. Mm. I keep telling people, just go where you like, go where it feels natural.
Rehearsal?
We rehearse 2 or 3 weeks of rehearsal before we go on set.
Luxury for most of us.
That's part of the writing process, and the writers are there, and the writers are always on set as well, because we slightly improvise around the scenes. I mean, everything is written down, and we shoot a script, and I won't even start shooting until I'm happy with the script. But then, just to get the sense of us eavesdropping on reality, I like to dirty the script up and get them to just, you know, maybe talk over each other a little bit and throw in a few new lines just to kind of provoke spontaneous responses. But the writers are always there on set, just in case something comes up as we're improvising that feels like it's got really funny potential. We can feed it into another scene. You know?
It must seem surreal to you that Hollywood does so many movies where this writer is kind of
banished.
Yeah.
Well, that whole process of writing it and then handing it over and doing it, it's not something I'm a writer, director.
Right.
I want to make my own projects. Mm-hmm. I love collaboration, and I want to work with people who are not precious and are not proprietorial, so are happy if they've spent all night writing something, we look at it and go, you know what, I think just a funny look would be just as funny than, you know, fine. You know, if the thing comes out as something that we're all wanted to make and all proud of, then everyone gets the credit,
right?
You know, and that way, and it's also a fast way of working as well, you know, it's a
you have to have the people, the actors who have the talent and the writers who have the talent. I mean, it's like amazing.
It's or just the confidence or not getting too self-conscious about it. I asked the writers to write the first draft in days because I don't want them to think too much about the phrasing. I want it to just spill out almost like stream of consciousness. And then we can cut it down and go back and can just say, well, this bit isn't funny. Let's cut all that. Let's change that character. Let's give him something else to do, you know. Because I want to get that first document, that first draft script or something, and casting from it, I want to get that early on in the process. And then everything else from then on falls in is a development of that, whether it's the casting or the rewriting.
Now, has that been is the way you've developed your work way of working through your entire career, or is it
not really? Bits of, you know, I've done some shows where, you know, lots of special effects and we have to storyboard it and the script is all locked in advance. You know, I've done stuff that's maybe a bit of both. You know, stuff that is scripted. I've done like the Alan Partridge stuff. That's all done in front of a studio audience.
Right.
So. In multi-camera, so we've got to know what everyone's going to say, so we know when to cut
so
to which camera. But we improvise in the rehearsals.
So that stuff is like legendary here. So we've seen very little.
Oh right, yeah.
It ran a little on BBC America,
yeah.
A little on PBS, but it's like that was kind of the, you know, thing over here for a while. Was
right,
getting
your
bootleg tapes of Alan Partridge.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Really? Bootleg?
Well, of course.
How much?
I got it from Australia.
Oh right.
In Australia, yeah. Made copies of it.
Yeah. And yeah, that's, you know, a lot of the comedy in that, a lot of the Alan's lines are things that we come up with as we're rehearsing.
Mm-hmm. So does that kind of fame, I mean, younger man at that point,
yeah.
A kid really,
yeah.
You know, and all of a sudden that's the hot thing.
Yeah.
Is that mess with your head? Is the British mindset different about it?
No, I don't know. And I'm very, I think something like the Alan Partridge thing obviously means a lot more to, in terms of Steve Coogan's kind of public persona, because he's clearly, you know, he plays Alan as well as writes Alan. So he's the one that takes the public kind of response to it.
The writers seem to be given kind of more of the, like almost like the stage respect that writers are given in British television,
right.
Seems to be more of that.
Possibly, but I detect in American television now the writers are beginning to...
They're demanding more,
you know, I mean, what we don't have in the UK is that tradition that you have in American television of the writers graduating to become the directors or the producers or the showrunners.
Mm-hmm.
In the UK, there's still a sense of the producer comes on board, hires a director, and then the writer is there. He's around or she's around, but, you know, it's difficult to then get the next stage up. So I'd like to see that broken down.
So was it hard for you to get the money and this all set up for this movie?
For this film? No, it was good because there was this original series that I did called The Thick of It, which had Peter Capaldi in it and set in a ministry. It was a different ministry, a different cast, but...
But he is a murderer.
But
so he just kills everybody.
He's a verbal torturer.
Yes.
He's the only guy who can waterboard with his mouth, yes. But BBC Films... were on board very, very quickly. They wanted to work with me, and when I said I want to do this story, they thought, great. And they could see, you know, from a commercial point of view, the idea of getting a US cast involved always has, you know, opens up possibilities and so on. What I didn't want to do is do one of these, sometimes in the UK we do films that, and we've got one American in it, you know, for that sale, you know, and it just looks like they've just been shipped in just to so that they can be on the poster.
But now we have the reverse. We have Carey Mulligan in every American movie this fall.
Oh, right.
Playing Americans almost in every one of them.
Well, every American actor is actually a British actor with an American accent now, isn't it?
So, the secret trick, yes.
You know, so I didn't want that. What I liked was the story was really about how the Brits were used in the build-up to the war. And then I thought that kind of appealed, the idea of having two casts almost, and spending maybe the first third of the film seeing them in parallel, and then they come together, you know.
So is the politics of it part of what drove you to make this particular
project? I'm always fascinated by the political process, and funny enough, I wanted to make a funny film, but I didn't know what I wanted to wait till I got the story.
Right.
And
this was pre-Bush, would you have made this movie?
Didn't expect that, you know, a war film was going to be my comedy film.
Right.
I really didn't. But the more I read about the dysfunction within the relationship between the State Department and the Pentagon, and how the Blair and his entourage were just almost starstruck by being in the Oval Office, and how they lost their whole set of principles because they were suddenly with these superstars.
Right.
I just thought, you know, you can scream at that, or else you think, that's a farce. That is a farce. Let's do it like fast. And I have always, you know, my favorite films are comedies actually that are not nervous of doing big things, you know, The Great Dictator or Dr. Strangelove or MASH or Brazil or, you know, and I don't think comedy you know, a subject by being dealt with it as a comedy, I don't think that subject is diminished by it being a comedy. If anything, I think a comedy allows you to approach that subject from all sorts of surprising angles and really analyze it.
You get right up to Richard Lester, but you don't quite go...
Oh, right, yeah.
Because there is a reality to it. It's stunning how real it is, as silly as it is.
But it's also reducing it, saying, you know, these people know. You see, you go past these big grand buildings in Washington, you think everyone in there must know what they're doing.
Right.
But, you know, you go down Wall Street and you look at the banks and you think everyone in there must know what they're doing. And then you discover, no, we were just sort of, everyone else was borrowing money. We thought we'd borrow some. Didn't realize it was all going to end in this nightmare. And similarly, you know, you go through the buildings into the, and you meet the people and they're all going, no. We're sort of making it up as we go along, really.
So are you telling us your next movie is going to be in a bank? Is that the...
Well, I don't know.
In the Golden Sacks of London?
No. The next thing I want to do, I want to do a slapstick movie. I want to do a good sort of visual, physical comedy, chases. And, you know, I'm a big fan of Buster Keaton and his... the fact that he does things literally, you know, how he... is it Sherlock? No, Steamboat Jim. Steamboat Bill Jim, the Hurricane. He's in a hospital ward and the hurricane blows the hospital away and he just got a building and lifted it away.
Has anybody been doing that in England? Or?
No, no, because everything's sort of CGI and I like the idea of just doing stuff for real.
Well, we have like the Farrelly brothers here talking about doing the Three Stooges as a feature.
That's
kind of retro, but also kind of like we haven't seen it in so long. Yeah. It's kind of fun to...
I like the idea of just lots of funny visual gags. Yeah.
So you just get your group together and just come up with every gag you can come up with in the world?
Yeah, but find the right story, the right characters, cast early, you know, work on the characters and then just think, right, what would be really stupid things to put them in? And
so do you feel the pinch in British film? I mean, there's always filmmakers complaining about the...
It's tricky, I mean, but it's happening all over. I think, you know, a lot of people who might have been able to fund a film themselves now have to co-produce and...
Right.
I know that I want to limit, you know, put a limit on my budget and stuff so that it's not getting too big, too ambitious, so that it's achievable quickly, you know. I'd like to be based as much as possible in the UK, but I loved the whole experience of working with the American cast. And,
well, I know you were having meetings today, but I mean, have you been seduced by Hollywood? Is it?
Well, I'm more than happy if they're happy to hand over some money. I have a very firm idea of what it is I want to make and, you know, as much as possible stick to it and work with people who kind of buy into that way of working and so on. I don't want to start saying, you know, I'm a director for hire and get 100 scripts every week and that's not how I've worked. I'm not sure I could do that well, to be honest. You know, I'm not sure I'd be any good at that. I'm better, I think, you know, doing the thing that I think I would be good at doing and then finding the right people who I think would be really good at making it work, you know.
Does being Scottish matter?
I don't know.
I mean, is this...
You know, people say because I'm sort of Scottish Italian and there's maybe that element of always feeling slightly outside the group of people you're with, being able to sort of stand back and being a bit more objective.
Is there a difference in the creative community? I mean, do people gather by their nations anymore?
No, I haven't noticed
old days.
That. No.
The Irish and the Scottish don't want to make movies together.
No.
Or does it matter? I mean, is it just...
Doesn't bother me, no. No, I mean, I just want to find like-minded people, really.
And is it easy? I mean, have you done theatre in London?
No, I've done an opera. I wrote the libretto to an opera that started this called Skin Deep. It's a comic opera set in a plastic surgery clinic. And it's currently about to receive its Austrian premiere. So
how do you get into something like that?
I was asked. A composer called David Sawyer, had an opera commissioned and he liked my stuff. And he said, you know, I want to do a funny opera about plastic surgery, are you interested? And I love classical music and, you know, grew up with Verdi and Puccini kind of playing full volume in the background from my parents. And I just thought, God, that would be, you know, how could you say no to that?
It's kind of an unusual request.
It's unusual. And then you turn up and, you know, a couple of years later, there you are in a theater and somebody has built an enormous vat of body parts, and there's a chorus dressed in body costumes singing your stupid words, and you just think, how did that happen?
Well, speaking of how did that happen, you came to Sundance a few months ago, and the response in this country, I mean, really, at Sundance, you were one of two or three movies where people were just on the floor,
couldn't
stop talking about the movie. Was that a surprise?
That was, because actually, I don't go through the process of, like, testing, you know. I did do a few little, as I was editing, a few private screenings, just to ask people, where does it stop being funny? Where does it feel too long? Where does it feel too slow? Is it not clear? So the editing process and all that. But the first real screening in front of, you know, paying public was at Sundance.
That was really the first thing.
That was the first.
Not in England?
No.
Wow.
Because it was all set to come out in England in April.
Right.
And this was January. Huh. And I sat down at the screening thinking, oh my God, I hope this is all right. Oh, I've no idea. And then when people started laughing, I thought, it's fine, it's fine.
Has it played different in each of the different places? I know you were in Seattle and...
No, I mean, I'm told, I didn't get to Seattle, but the US cast went to it, they said it was great. It was like a 3,000-seater.
Yeah, it was the opening night at Seattle.
Yeah, and they just said it was extraordinary. You know, the sound of 3,000 people laughing, you know, is... But I love that. I've always, you know... My brother, elder brother, used to just take me to the new Woody Allen film every year, and I love things like Airplane and Spinal Tap, and just that sitting in a cinema laughing is what I wanted to do. You know, that's what I've wanted to do all this time. So it's just great to get to that point where, you know.
And getting people thinking too is not so bad.
Well, hopefully, you know, but you know, as much as possible, I've wanted to, you know, stress the comic element. But if they leave thinking, oh my God, then that's fine.